We'll begin the module on peer instruction with a story from Eric Mazur. Professor Eric Mazur is the Balkonsky Professor of Physics and Applied Physics at Harvard University. He came to Harvard in 1982 and joined the faculty in 1984. In the late 80s and early 90s, Eric was instrumental in beginning peer instruction as an effective instructional technique to be used at the undergraduate level. Let's listen to Eric as he tells us the story of how this all happened.
So I started teaching at Harvard in 1984, 30 years ago. And when I started teaching, I never asked myself, how am I going to teach? What is the approach that I'm going to use? I simply did what my instructors had done to me. I lectured. And what happened was that very quickly, I received signs that I was doing the right thing. Students liked me as an instructor, gave me high evaluations, even though I was teaching a course that nobody wanted to take, physics for pre-meds. And they did well on what I considered to be difficult exam problems. And very quickly, I started to believe that I was the world's best physics teacher. That illusion, because it turned out to be an illusion, unraveled around the early 1990s. So after teaching for about 7 years, when I gave my students a survey of conceptual questions that demonstrated that they did not even learn the most basic principle in my course, the principle of force. So that led to some soul searching. I was all of a sudden no longer the world's best physics teacher. In fact, I wasn't even able to teach them the most basic concept in the course. And somehow, serendipitously, the solution to this problem presented itself to me. Students were very worried about their performance on this test. It was not only me, it was them as well. And they asked me to arrange a special session at night where I'd go through each and every of those questions that I had asked them that revealed their ignorance about the concept of force. And I remember coming to a question that in my mind was totally trivial. And I just made a few sketches on the board and said, you know, this is the answer. To me, that was so obvious that there was not even any further discussion necessary. And I turned around and I could see at once that they were confused. So I asked, is there a question? They were so confused, they could not even answer the question. So I thought, this is serious. I erased the board, I started over again. I thought, I'm gonna bring in some other principles and try to address what I perceive to be their misconceptions. And during the next 8 minutes, I managed to produce what I thought was the most brilliant explanation you could possibly think of. And at the end of 8 minutes, I turn around, facing them again rather than the board, only to see that they looked even more confused and they could still not articulate a coherent question. But I knew that half of them had given the right answer. So in a moment of despair, I don't know, this was not really thought out, I just told them, why don't you discuss it with your neighbor? And I had 250 students in the class, and I remember this moment vividly. The whole classroom erupted in chaos. They were all talking, they forgot about me in front of the classroom. And what's more, in just 2 minutes, they figured it out. At first I thought, how can it be? I, the expert, have tried for 10 minutes explaining it to them, and they talk just 2 minutes and get it? At first it didn't make any sense to me, but then I thought about it. Imagine you have two students sitting next to each other, John and Mary. John does not quite understand it and doesn't have the right answer. Mary has the right answer. On average, Mary is more likely to convince John than the other way around, simply by the force of logic. But the really important point is this. Mary is more likely to convince John than Professor Mazur in front of the class. Why? Because she's only recently learned it. She still knows what the difficulties are that a beginning learner faces. It was not that long ago that she struggled with it. Whereas Professor Mazur has learned it such a long time ago. To him, it is so clear that he cannot even imagine that somebody doesn't understand it. It's what my colleague Steven Pinker calls the curse of knowledge. So once I saw that, I thought, wow, I should implement this in the classroom. So the following year that I was teaching, I said to myself, look, what is education exactly? It's, in a sense, a two-step process. One is information transfer, but that's not enough. As the learner has to do something with that information, assimilate it, build the mental models that permit the learner to take the knowledge out of that information, to apply it into a new context. So the second step, that assimilation, is as important as the, if not more important, than the first step, the information transfer. In the traditional approach to teaching, all of the emphasis is on that first step. We lecture to the students, we transfer the information to them. The assimilation, or I think Piaget would have probably called it accommodation, the aha moments, the I get it, typically is left to the students on his or her own outside the classroom, when doing problem sets, when reviewing notes, and so on. So it's kind of ironic that we put all of our emphasis on what I consider to be the easy step of education, the transfer of information, leaving the hard part to the students. Of course, way back when, before there were books, before there were MOOCs, before there was the internet, you had no choice, because there was no other way of transferring the information. So back then, in 1991, I decided that I was going to throw the information step out. Rather than regurgitating the notes to my students, I would ask them to read the notes before coming to class. Later, I sometimes also asked them to watch a pre-recorded lecture before class, but either way, it's the same thing. The transfer of information occurs before the classroom. And then in class, rather than teaching by telling, I teach by questioning.